Yeah, let me show you the difference between showing your work and not showing your work here, especially with this one. Showing your work is not this. And it's not, you know, it's not wrong, x is 6. But it's obvious to everybody that x has to be 6. With the way we use algebra to solve this equation, and want to get in the habit of doing this because we're going to want to apply it to other situations, more complicated equations, okay, where we can see that 5 times some quantity that we don't know is equal to 30. So in order to get just that quantity by itself, we would what? Divide by 5, divide by 5. 5 divided by 5, what's that?
One
times x. What's 1 times x?
X.
Yeah, okay. That's what we're trying to get to. 1 times x equals 6, so x equals 6.
Almost forgot how to do this.
Looks like you figured it out.
Yeah, I caught myself, because this doesn't feel right. And I started thinking about it.
I want to divide, but I know it seems, like I said, it seems silly to show your work on that, but when it's part of a more complicated equation, you want to be prepared for that. Be able to use that tool to solve that equation. It's not always that obvious. Especially if you have 5x equals 73. Is it obvious what x is? But we wouldn't have too much trouble figuring it out, right? If we do what on both sides?
Divide by 5.
And whatever 73 divided by 5 is, that must be what x is. How about this guy here? Do to both sides to just isolate x.
Combine like terms first. So like you gotta carry the 5 over to 12 and you make it like plus 5.
Well, let's see. Let's add 5 to both sides and let's see. Why is that? What is negative 5 plus 5?
0.
So we have x plus 0. And what's x plus 0?
X.
That's what's going on.
Yeah.
We're getting a plus 0. Okay. Equals 17. So if x plus 0 equals 17, then x must be 17. Because it's the only way that equation could be true. How about this last one? So we have 7x plus 0, right? But we won't write that this time. 7x is equal to 31. So here we are, an equation where it's not obvious what x is. It's not obvious that x should be, you know, whatever point, whatever. So how are we going to figure out what x is?
You divide it.
Divide by 7, divide by 7, x equals whatever 31 divided by 7 is.
It's 4.42857.
4.42857. And forever and ever, this will go on and on and on. We'll see a pattern repeat, but it'll never end. Never end. Okay, let's try some more equations. Try another one like that. Say I've got a negative 4 divided by 5, and negative divided by positive is going to be a what? Negative. Negative divided by positive is negative, positive divided by negative is negative, negative divided by negative is positive. So I would do that, and then if I really wanted to like throw down some long division here, I would just remember my answer is going to be negative, and then go for that long division, right? 5 goes into 4 0 times, so 1 decimal, so 5 goes into 40. 8 times, so 0.8. Okay. But we solve this equation? Subtract 9 out of 9 minus 9 is 0, so we have negative 4x plus 0 equals 5. And then we have
divided by 4.
Divided by negative 4. Right? It's negative 4. What we want is to have a 1x, 1 times x, which we won't get if we do negative 4 by positive 4, we'll get negative 1 times x, which we could make work. But if we divide by negative 4, then negative 4 divided by negative 4 is positive 1. And you get negative 5/4. That's fine. You could put negative 1.25 if you wanted to do that. Fraction improper or not, it's fine. Fine answer. Okay, since again, so we get 1 times x. We have 5/8 times x, so how do we get a 1 times x?
Multiply the reciprocal of 5/8, so 8/5 times.
Let's see, right? We get 40 over 40. 40 divided by 40 is 1. So, yes, 1x is the result on the left side. And that's great. Now we'll know what x is as soon as we're done with all of this business. How do we multiply these fractions? Straight across, 7 times 8, 56. 5 times 1 is 5. 56 over 5. If you divided 56 by 5 and got some kind of a 11 point something, then that's fine.
11.2. You just do cross multiply. What?
When we multiply fractions, we multiply straight across. 7 times 8, 56. 1 times 5 is 5.
So what about addition? You don't do it with addition?
You don't cross multiply with addition either.
I know.
Okay.
No, you can't go straight across with addition.
Oh, no, you can't go straight across with addition. Addition, we need to find what?
Common
denominator. Any one right way to start, so how did one of you guys start?
I took the easy way, so I just did negative 2 minus 2 and 13 minus 2.
So 11.
And then you need to find a common denominator between the 5, 6, and 3/4.
Okay, because these are like terms, we're going to put them together just by combining their coefficients, just like 7x minus 2x would be 7 minus 2 is 5 times x, right? So we need to find a common denominator in order for that to happen, because what we're going to have is whatever 5, 6 minus 3/4 is times x. Whatever that is times x. We need a common denominator. What would be that common denominator?
24.
Okay, so we would multiply this by
4.
4, and this by 4, and this by
6,
and this by
6,
and we have 20/24 minus 18/24, whatever that is, will be the coefficient of x, 20 minus 18, so 2/24, so 1/12 x. That's all still equal to 11.
How are you getting 11?
We subtract the 2 from the very beginning. Subtract 2 from both sides, that cancels out. That's a 0 now, and 13 minus 2 is 11.
Okay.
All right, now we have 1 12th x equals 11, and now we're going to figure out what x is. Divided by
1 12th.
Okay. Divide this by 1 12th. And 1 12th divided by 1 12th is 1. So that's good. 1 times x. How do we divide 11 by 1 12th? Times 12 over 1. So x equals 132 over 1, which is unnecessary to write over 1. 132 over 1 is just 132.
Question. Do we have to simplify it when we do it? Because if you do it all the way around, you can get a different number.
Shouldn't get anything different if you, like, if you leave it as 2 over 24?
Yeah.
It should be the same.
Because
if I do it that way instead, I'll wind up with x equals 11 over 1 times 24 over 2, right? Which will give me 264 over 2, which is 132.
Okay. That's why I meant, like, when I simplify, I meant like the 264.
We would want to, since this is divisible by 2, we want to go ahead and make it. You want to make the numbers easy to use as possible. Way to start this equation, solving this equation. So, Justin.
I just distributed it first.
Great. Distributed. That gives us 15x minus 20 plus 2 equals 17. Just a quick note, you could solve this without ever distributing, but we'll look at that later. Distributing certainly is correct. It certainly is true that 5 times this parentheses is equal to 15x minus 12. Now what? Sorry, minus 20.
Minus 2, or 17 minus 2.
Minus 2, both sides, 15x minus 20 equals 15.
And then I added 20 to 15.
What's that?
And then I added 20 to 15.
We had 20 to both sides, didn't you? Right, negative 20 plus 20 is 0. X plus 0 equals 35.
Mm-hmm.
And then
finish
it out, 15 on both sides. X equals 35 over 15. Well, they both are divisible by 5, so we might as well make it 7 over 3. 7 thirds. Could 2.333333, that's not as great. Unless you put 2.3 with a repeating symbol. I like 7 thirds better. So here's how we could solve it without ever distributing anything. And see, I subtract 2 on this step here. No reason why we can't do that at the very beginning, right? 5 times 3x minus 4 equals 15. Well, instead of distributing this 5 into the parentheses, and then later, you see how there's a factor of 5 in there when I divide by 15? Well, let's just divide this side by 5. That's really like 5 fifths times 3x minus 4 over 1. Equals 3, right? 5 fifths times 3x minus 4. So same thing, if we multiply straight across, we get 5 times 3x minus 4. There it is. 5 times 1, there's 5. And it was 5 divided by 5?
1.
1. So we just have 3x minus 4 equals 3. And I won't make anybody say this because we all know we're going to add 4 to both sides. We're going to get 3x equals 7. We're going to divide by 3 again. 7 thirds. Just like we did here. Next. But either way, gets the same answer, and we showed all of our work. We just did different work. Distribute or divide by the thing that's to be distributed. It's fine, either way. You guys feel like you can solve some fairly simple linear equations? You might have to combine like terms, we might have to distribute or even avoid distributing. You need to multiply by the reciprocal of some fraction. But it seems like we're all on the same page here, so now we're gonna move on to functions. This should still be review of you guys got through last year, if I'm not mistaken, right? You guys did some functions, some graphs, right? A refresher, I can tell by the testing at the beginning of the year that we need a refresher on that. So that's what we're going to do, but we're going to go through it as quickly as we can. So functions, who can tell me what a function is? So much of algebra is about functions. Worth our time to talk about what a function is exactly. Does the word function sound familiar? Yeah? Then, Cameron, you feel like you got a definition of function that we can put up on the board?
Sort of.
Okay.
Like it's a kind of a answer. Input output.
Those at least are two really important words when it comes to functions. Okay? Input and output. What do you do with input?
You put stuff in, put numbers in.
Putting in. Things that go in are input. What's output?
Stuff that comes out after
stuff
you keep
comes
stuff
out after you input something. It's like a math machine.
Math machine.
It's like a math machine. Okay. Minus all the shading that Cameron likes to do, I'm going to draw you a math machine. Okay. What's this?
That's an input.
Input. What's this?
Output.
Your output.
And what decides what happens inside here?
Magic.
Not magic.
The math that it.
The math, okay?
The function.
So, yeah, whatever the function is, there needs to be a place for that to go in, and there needs to be a place for it to come out, okay? So, how do we usually symbolize the place where stuff goes into a function?
X.
Very good. And that very vague-sounding question, it's a good answer. X. X is where things go in, and where do things come out?
Y.
There we go. Piecing this together nicely. So can somebody give me an example of a function that has a place for something to go in and a place for something to come out? What's that? Yeah, I'm asking you just completely make this up. A place that has some place for input to go and some place for output to come out.
Y equals 3x plus b.
Y equals 3x plus now b. I don't know how to
seven.
Add. Okay, 7, a number, right? There is a perfectly fine example of a function. This is an example of a linear function. Let's take this function that Cameron has forced us to use and fill out this table for that function. Okay? About that. Okay, fill out that function. There's your input, here's your output.
Is this just another way how to figure out y equals 3x plus 3?
Another way to figure out that y equals 3x plus b? I'm not sure what you mean.
Y equals 7x plus b. That's the...
I mean, 7. Is this just another way how to figure out y?
To figure out y, well... We can't figure out y.
Okay, fine.
We can let y show itself by plugging in something for x.
Okay.
Right. It's just a machine. It doesn't have a definite x or y because both are up in the air. Both are variables. We call them variables because they vary. Whenever we plug in x now, that will determine what y is. Whenever we can plug in something for y, and that will determine what x would have had to have been. Right. But for now, we'll just do some inputs and outputs. Simple input and output. So let's complete this table for that function. You know what that means?
Solve it.
We're gonna do just 5 different times, right? -2 goes in, what comes out? I don't know, you tell me. -1 goes in, what comes out? -0 goes in, what comes out? You just fill out the table, show me what comes out for each of those inputs. Go. Just waiting for everybody to grab a pencil. Okay, so I'm gonna plug this in for x, see what happens. 3 times -2 plus 7. Now the order of operations, we all agree to use, is we multiply these two first, so we get -6 plus 7, we get 1. Right? Next, 3 times -1 plus 7, that's -3 plus 7 is 4. 3 times negative 3 times 0 plus 7, that's 0 plus 7, that's 7. 3 times 1 plus 7 equals 3 plus 7 equals 10. 3 times 2 plus 7 equals 6 plus 7 equals 13. 10 for x. Could you follow some kind of a pattern to tell you what the output would be once you got to 10? What's that? Oh, we think it'd be odd, okay. So we've got odd, even, odd, even, odd.
Next one would be 16.
The next one would be 16? You said it would be what, odd or even?
Odd.
It'd be odd, because every even gets an odd, right? Odd, even. If you think of this as even, you get odd. Even, odd. Okay, why do you say, Cameron, the next one would be 16?
I just add 3 to it.
Add 3? Does that seem to be the pattern? 3? 3? 3? 3? 3 would make this 16, and then? 19. Well, let's not do this one by 1. We're going to go from here to there. We're going to add 3 and 3 and 3 and 3. How many times do we have to add 3 to get right from the 2 to the 10?
8.
8 more 3s we have to add on? Put us at where? 37. 8 more 3s. That would be 24. Yeah, 37. Oh, so I said not to do. I said to follow a pattern, get from here to there, right? If we had to add 8 more 3s, we would just add 8 times 3. What's 8 times 3? 24. Plus 13,
37,
confirmed, plug 10 in there, 30 plus 7, 37, right?
30
times
10, plus 7, 37. Oh, you did 37, I didn't do it, I just checked it out.
Right, you did this.
Yeah, I did that, no, in the very beginning,
yeah.
You said that's what you told me not to do.
Yeah.
I didn't do it until I was
But you were checking it.
Yeah, checking.
But you did this, something like this, and got 37?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. So there's this pattern, like every time x goes up by 1, finish my sentence. Every time x goes up by 1,
y goes up by 3.
Y goes up by 3. Okay? And a real like over, up, over x, up 3 on the y, over x, over 1 on the x, up 3 on the y. Okay? X increases by 1, y increases by 3. Saying, isn't that always true? Or is this always true? Like, and then we try it again. We usually try again with a specific example and say, hey, look at that, that's happening again. Let's see if we can somehow show that that would always happen. Right? So let's just try it again for another example, like y equals, let's try negative. What happens then? Negative what?
2.
U? Oh, then we definitely want to use a negative number. Negative 5x, no, that's too easy. Negative 6x plus 5. So it's not, it's a shared factor of 6. Okay. Let's do the same thing. Let's just start by plugging in negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2. Let's see what happens. Negative 6 times negative 2 plus 5. Negative 6 times negative 2?
12.
Positive 12. 12 plus 5, 17. Negative 6 times negative 1 plus 5 equals positive 6 plus 5 equals 13.
11.
Next one's 11?
No.
No, the next one's 5. Oh, whoops.
Wait, not 13. Is it 13? Remember, did I write something down wrong?
You wrote something wrong.
6 plus 5 is not 13.
It's 11.
11 was, hey, that's supposed to be 11. Now you get it. Negative 6 times 0 plus 5 equals 0 plus 5 equals 5. Okay. 6 times 1 plus 5 equals 6 plus 5 equals
negative 1.
Negative 1. Can we use a pattern to get to the next output?
Negative 7.
Adding a negative 6, so we'd get to negative 7. It would sure seem like down 6, down 6, down 6 into negative 1, down 6 more should be negative 7. Negative 6 times 2 plus 5 equals negative 12 plus 5 equals negative 7. And look, all of these have a 5, right? And all we're doing is we're stepping up the x's by 1 every time. So what we get is, like, we just step through multiples of 6, starting, in this case, with 12, and now we have, that's 2 times 6, and now 1 times 6, and 0 times 6, and negative 1 times 6, and negative 2 times 6. We're just going through the multiples of 6. Okay. Subtracting those, or I guess we're adding those to 5, and so naturally, every time x goes up by 1, we're going to subtract another 6 from so, going down by 6. So this pattern is more like x goes, like we move over in the x by 1, right? And the y goes, right, this is 1. The y goes how much down this way?
6.
You see what I'm saying? It's the pattern is x goes over 1, y goes down by 6. Well, if I start from there and I go over another 1 in the x direction, then I'll go down another 6, right, in the y direction. And when we see that on a graph, we call that the what? This stepping pattern we call what? Not stairs, but that's not a bad word. It's a descriptive word that tells like kind of what's going on. About like that's a point, that's a point, and that's a point. We have a line going through
parallelism.
that's the kind of graph that it is, but this pattern of going over one and down six.
That's a negative slope.
That's the slope. It's the slope. What a slope. This is a slope of negative six, because every time we go over one in the x, we go down on the y by six. So this is like what y is gonna do, and this one, this is the number one, and this is what x is gonna do. Right? Okay. Let's try this function, y equals 2/3 x minus 4. So I'm going to start at negative 3. I'm only going to tell you where to start. Then I want you to choose what the next input, and the next input should be. Okay. You could go to negative 2 if you want, but if you can think of a better input than negative 2, an easier one to plug in for x, then use that one. Just work your way from negative 3 going toward the positive values. And try to choose the easiest values of x that you can possibly think of to plug in there. Make the multiplication simple. To get you started, try plugging negative 3 in there first. See what happens.
Yeah.
Okay. See why I chose negative 3, or see if you can guess why I chose negative 3. Okay. Let's plug in negative 3 and see why I chose it. 2/3 times negative 3 minus 4. Okay, and 2/3 times negative 3 is what?
6/3.
6/3? Negative 6/3.
Negative 6/3.
Negative 6/3. Well, what's nice about negative 6/3? Like, what's nice about 6 and 3 together?
8 equals
2. 6 is divisible by 3. Right? So, by choosing 3, I made the numerator divisible by 3, and that certainly was helpful, right? Because then I can divide it by 3 easily. And so I have negative 2 minus 4, negative 6. So when we think about plugging a different number in here for x and multiplying it by 2/3, what's the next number after this negative 3 that you would choose to plug in for x? Negative 1. Okay, well that's going to give me 2/3 times negative 1 minus 4. That's going to be negative 2/3 minus 4. How am I going to combine negative 2/3 and negative 4? How do I do that?
Well,
1. I need to find a
common
denominator. Okay. Did I need a common denominator here? No, because this worked out so nicely. While this will be correct, I mean, it will be another like point on the graph, if you can think of it that way, it's going to take a little more work. So I'm going to have to multiply this by 3 and multiply this by 3. So I get negative 2/3 minus 12/3 is negative 14/3. Or negative 4 2/3. The thing that was nice about this is when we were all done, it was just integer, negative 6, no fractions. So what number could we plug in for x that's bigger than negative 3 that would make it so we don't wind up with fractions?
0.
2/3 times 0 minus 4 is, pretty plain to see, negative 4. How about after 0?
3.
2/3 times 3 over 1 is 4. 3's cancel. We're left with 2 minus 4, negative 2. Branson, how about after 3?
After 3,
6. 6 is good. 2/3 times 6 over 1 minus 4. 3 and 6 have a common factor? Cross cancel those?
Yes.
3 and 6. 3 divided by 3 is 1. 6 divided by 3 is 2. 2, 2 times 2 is 4, and 4 minus 4, 4 minus 4 is 0. How about after 6, Noah? What do you think would be, even negative 3 has been nice, 0 is good, 3, 6, what would you do after 6? 9? 9, 2 thirds times 9 over 1, minus 4, they get 3, and 9 have a factor of 3 in common. This is 2 times 3 is 6, minus 4 is 2. We can just plug anything we want in for x. We would want to choose, now we're seeing what kinds of numbers would we like to plug in for x.
3. Divisible by 3.
Divisible by 3? There's also there's another word for that?
Odds.
Well,
multiplication.
Odds not a, well, this is an odd even. That's an even number. It's still divisible by 3. What's a number, was it a word or a number that's divisible by 3? Three is a multiple of 3. 0 is a multiple of 3. Seems kind of weird to think of it that way. 0 is a multiple of everything then. 3 is a multiple of 3. 6 and 9 multiples of 3. They all are divisible by 3. So now the pattern is we want to, like, how much of a change do we want to see in the x? We go from negative 3 to 0, which is how much of a change? 3. We want to go up by 3. We want to go up by 3. We want to go up by 3. Up by 3. Let's look at the y. How is the y changing from negative 6 to negative 4?
2.
2. And from there to there, negative 4 to negative 2?
2.
2 again. From negative 2 to 0?
2.
2 again. From 0 to
2.
2. And so if we went to, what do you think the next number might be?
12.
12. Our output should be?
4.
4. We continue this pattern of x increases by, and y increases by
2.
Well, look at that equation there.
2
and 3.
All of them rise over the.
This is how much y changes if you let x change by this much. You know that delta? That letter delta means change. Isn't that in physics or chemistry or something like that? Delta,
yes.
T, usually the change in temperature. Okay. So y will change this much. That'll be the change in y if this is, if you let this be the change in x, right? Every time x goes up by 3, y goes up by 2. Let's transfer that to a graph. So how, tell me how I would transfer any of this information over to the graph. X would be negative 3. And what do? I just put a point there?
No.
You don't put a point there?
Up 2.
Up 2? Up 2? Put it there?
Yes.
Zero. Let's talk about what this means here.
The rise over run.
The graph doesn't mean rise over run. It's certainly there, it's certainly part of it. So let's talk about these two things that are on the board right now. What are these two things called?
X and Y.
X and Y, what? Axes, axis is one, axis is two or more. X axis, y axis. Okay, we got positive this direction, negative this direction, positive this direction, negative that direction. Okay. So, you know, why do we have these things? Because this guy named Descartes thought it would be a really nifty way to show how functions behave with a picture rather than just a table or some ordered pairs or just telling you about the function verbally. he said we could make a picture out of it, right? So how do I translate this function into a graph? Seems to be something I don't fully understand. You put points up on that graph, right?
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead.
Those points represent a function.
Somehow they do, yeah, in a very, yes, they represent the function.
There you go, that's fine.
What's a function? We talked, this is going back to the beginning of talking about functions. You said a function was?
When you put something in, you get something out.
Put something in, you get something out. So the graph must show that put something in, get something out relationship, okay? Do we have to put some things in and get some things out?
Yeah.
Yes.
How many of those examples do we have?
A lot.
That many on the board.
As many as on the board. Give me one example of one. This goes in and this comes out.
-3x, -6y.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you might be used to seeing this. -3 for x, -6 for y. That's nothing fancy. That's just, well, maybe it is exactly what it is. Just fancy. Nothing new. No information has been gained here, right? I'm only telling you that x is -3 and that y is -6. You already knew that. But I guess it is kind of fancy. It's neat, it's clean, it's concise. And it tells me that for this function, if you plug in -3, you get out -6. How do we show that on the graph?
You put those points.
You put those points. You want to put those points?
Do I want to put those points?
And show me what you mean by that.
Well, see, you put -3 on the x-axis.
Okay.
But the -6 on the y-axis is 1, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Is in the positive direction for y?
Yes.
Okay, negative is down. Everybody agree that that tells us that x is -3 and y is -6?
Yeah.
All in one little point, we know two pieces of information, what x is and what y is, and that relates back to this function here because why does it relate back to this function? Because if
the point,
if x goes by 3, y goes down by 2. Goes up by 3.
This point, what does this one point tell me about this function?
It's 3, 6 over 3. Oh, sorry, it's, yeah, 6 over 8.
What's a function again?
Some input and output.
Input, output. So what does this tell me about the input and output of this function?
It's negative.
All of them are
this
negative?
Is our output.
What's that?
That's our output.
What's our output?
The point.
The point is our output?
Mm-hmm. Input's the... We can finish this.
What's the input?
The input's the x.
Okay, so how does this tell me what the input is?
It's y.
Because it's y?
Well, y is the output.
Y is the output. So how does this point tell me what the input is and what the output is?
6.
Ah, oh, that's right.
Showing the relationship between the two.
How? How is this showing the relationship between two things?
Is there a book right here?
I'll give you a hint. It's doing it by being somewhere.
It's
in a specific place.
It's a,
on this entire planet. We're going to put a point anywhere. This point's right there. How does this point tell me something about this function? What is it telling me about the function? Your function's input, output, just comes down to input and output. What information does it give me about input and output just by being right here?
Where is it located on the chart?
Okay, where is it located? The third quadrant.
Yeah.
It's in the third quadrant. We can get more specific than that. Tell you
negative 3, negative 6.
at negative, what does that mean, at negative 3, negative 6? What's negative 3 about it?
Coordinates
are negative 3, negative 6. Yeah, we're dancing all around it. That's where it is. It's at, if I were to find that point, I would have to go
negative 3, negative 6.
There it is. Right? The place where it is, these are its coordinates. And so this negative 3 tells me what about the function?
So that's where it's started. That's the point.
It's 3.
That's
2. It's 3 to the left of the center, and it's down 6 from the center.
You're describing in a different way where the point is.
Right.
We've got that. We've got where the point is. What is it telling me about the function? What's the negative 3 telling me about the function?
Oh, it's a multiply 3.
Let's start again with if. If.
If negative. If x is negative 3 from y is negative 6.
Exactly. If x is negative 3, we can see it happening over here. If x is negative 3, then y is negative 6. That's all that point is doing. By being in the place where it is, it's telling me that if negative 3 is plugged in for x, negative 6 will come out for y. Input and output. It just tells me that particular input and output pair. Right? We have another pair of input and output. What was the next nice input that we liked?
Zero, negative 4.
We like zero, right? So here we travel over here to x is zero. We scoot over 3 to the right, and we're at x equals zero, right? And what was the y value that we got?
Negative 4.
Negative 4, right? Negative 4, negative 6, 4, yeah. And if we, it's hard to see because I'm just putting dots on this axis, but we're moving up to negative 4. Right? When I moved over 3, when x increased by 3, the output increased by 2. When I increase the x by 3, I increase the y by 2. Okay. Can I, are there points in here as well? Here's a point. Here's a point. There's a point at negative 3, negative 6. Here's a point at 0, negative 4. Are there points in between?
Yes.
Yeah, we found one. Negative 1 comma negative 14 over 3. Or negative 1 comma negative 2 and 2/3. Okay. Negative 1. Negative 2. No, negative 4. Excuse me. Negative 4 and 2/3. Puts it right about there. How many points are there between this point and that point?
A lot.
How many?
14.
How many points could I plot?
Infinite.
Right? How could, just give me an example how I could find one more point in between those two, between this point and that point.
1.1.
Negative 1.1?
Yeah.
Plug in negative 1.1 for x and see what comes out for y. What's another way we could find another point? Negative 2. Just keep plugging in any x that's between negative 3 and 0, and you'll, once you figure out what the y is, have another point. Another point, another point. Okay? And if we keep plotting those points, they'll just rise steadily along that pattern of moving over 3 and up 2. Right? If I move over another 3, it's a positive 3, since that was the next x value that was convenient. We move over 3. Well, we're going to find that the output there is 2 more than the previous output. If we go to the next convenient input of 6, we'll find that that output is 2 greater than this output. But that's no surprise, because every time we plug in something for x, the 3 cancels it, right? And then we just get some multiple of 2 to add on to that negative 4. Every time we move over 3, we're going to get the next multiple of 2. We're going to get one multiple of 2 bigger than that. We go from 0 to 3. Right? See, we go from 0 to 2. When we go from 3 to 6, we wind up going from 2 to 4. When we go from 6 to 9, we wind up adding 6 instead of 4. We just keep going up the next multiple of 2. And if I were to guess at where all the points in between these points were, since they've got 4 of them now, and they're lying, it seems like they're lying in what kind of a shape? Shape. It looks like if I were to plot all those points and plot them really close together and plot all infinity of them, they would get really close together and they would make this line. One thing I like to emphasize to students learning about graphing is that a graph is not two points and then a shape connecting them, a line connecting them, or even a curve connecting them. The line itself is made up of what?
Points.
Points. How many points?
Infinite.
An infinite number of points. Where do all those points come from?
By the... that.
By the that or that?
That one.
That?
That one, yeah.
They, all the points come from that?
Well... yes.
Yes. How?
By doing the function.
Doing the function. How do you do the function?
By replacing x.
Replacing x with something, a number, and then figuring out what y is, and then doing it over and over and over for all eternity, for eons and eons. And if we have all eternity to do this, we would plot all these infinite number of points, and there'd be so many points, and we could be so close together, we couldn't see in between them. There'd be no gaps left anymore. We get this shape. And in this case, the shape turns out to be a line. Okay. Because of the nature of the function, every time we move over 3 for x, we go to the next multiple of 3, and we just start increasing the y by 2. You just get the steady slope-like pattern, just over and up, and not all functions act that way, not all graphs act that way. But essentially, because x is only to the power of 1, that's what happens. It just has this nice, steady pattern. Over and up, maybe over and down if there's a negative involved somehow, you know? In this one, if I go back 3, I'll go down 2, back 3, down 2, back 3, down 2. Okay. So we've discovered the slope now.
Sort of.
You guys knew about the slope already, right,
yes.
Cameron? You knew about the slope already, but now what we've done is explain the slope. It's not a magical number. It's not just the way that we draw a graph of a line. We see that pattern. It really just comes from we want to be lazy and plug in the easiest number we can for x. Right? And in this case, the easiest thing to plug in for x is a number that you can divide by 3 evenly. Right. Well, given that, we should be able to. Should be able to figure out what the graph of this function looks like without too much work. Should be able to easily find 2 points, knowing that this kind of a function, it just has this steady pattern. X increases by so much, y increases by so much. All we need is kind of a starting point, which wouldn't be too hard to find. See if you can figure out what the graph of this function should look like. Reminder, it is a line shape. So,
you want
about a minute. So a graph is made of a bunch of points. So if I could find all those points where they are, then I should be able to draw that graph. Those points, those come from input and output, right? The easiest input I can put into this function is what?
Zero.
Zero is the easiest input I can put Because 0 times 5/8 is 0, minus 2 is?
Oh, I never take your stuff.
Negative 2, that's what we call our y-intercept. I know that the next best x value to plug in is 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I know if I move over 8, then I should move up
5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I know that this is going to be a line, so I know all of the points in between will be on a line, all the points past will be on a line, all the points this way will be on a line. All right, I'll see you next time. Have a good day.